Members of the rap group Public Enemy say it's just their version of fantasy. Their latest video, By the Time I Get to Arizona, shows blacks marching on that state's capital, killing officials for failing to adopt a Martin Luther King holiday. The governor of Arizona responded yesterday, calling the video racist. Supporters of the holiday were left wondering what was left of Dr. King's message of peace. And that was the subject of last night's Nightline.
When?
Now!
What do you want?
When?
Now! What do you want?
In Arizona today, another march on the state capitol. Another call for a state holiday to honor Martin Luther King, Jr.
What do you want?
They've been doing this here every year for the last 6 years. At times, their frustration echoes in the protest songs of the 60s.
We shall overcome someday.
But for some today, there is a new song, a new call to action.
This is Mr. Soldier. Public Enemy, security of the first world, and all aligned forces are traveling west to head off a white supremacist team to destroy the national celebration of Dr. Martin Luther King's birthday.
It's entitled By the Time I Get to Arizona by the rap group Public Enemy. The group says the music video, released earlier this month, is a revenge fantasy. It begins by accusing Arizonans of being racist for not adopting a King holiday.
What's a smiley face when a whole state's racist? Why wanna hound a chemicals? I wanna...
It portrays the rap group leading a paramilitary charge on the state house, killing politicians who refuse to honor King.
I'm on a one mission to get a politician to honor, or he's a goner by the time I get to Arizona.
The video, intercut with reenactments of King's assassination, portrays terrorists poisoning a legislator and blowing up a governor.
When I watched the video the first time, I kind of felt queasy inside, and I thought, my heavens, who would ever want to put something like this together?
Governor Fife Symington supports a King holiday in Arizona. As for the video...
The group who put this together basically are racists, because they made a racist statement, and they lumped everybody into the same category in this state, which is ridiculous.
Public Enemy has a history of controversy, usually stemming from its militant brand of black politics. But its politics have proven popular. The group's latest album, which includes By the Time I Get to Arizona, has sold almost 2 million copies nationwide.
I don't think I've ever seen an issue that was so emotionally charged that got everybody so involved with very, very strong feelings.
Is this ballot?
Arizona is the only state to put the idea of a King holiday to a vote. 2 years ago, the proposal was defeated by a narrow margin. But it will be back on the ballot this November.
Your video doesn't help us one iota in building relationships.
Warren Stewart, a local pastor, says the video perpetuates a stereotype that young black men are young violent men.
The proposed solution, or the portrayed solution, how to handle racial differences, assassination.
But it's a fantasy video, they say. It's
a... Does a 13-year-old understand it's a fantasy video? Does an 11-year-old boy in the ghetto who gets called nigger by two or three white teenagers who are driving by in the car, does he understand it's a fantasy?
Look around. Harry Elam is the director of a political action committee trying to get elected officials more responsive to the black community.
It's speaking about more than one holiday. It's just a representation of a lot of the struggles, a lot of the pains that blacks in all cities are going through. Housing, health, education, the welfare system being reformed. I'm saying that no longer are we going to be happy if it takes depicting some of this to wake the conscience up of America, so be it, by all means necessary.
But you don't think it's encouraging violence?
No, not at all. Not at all.
Some consider rap, like other forms of music before it, as a kind of catalyst for social change. But as rap attracts an ever larger audience, the question is whether groups like Public Enemy are exposing or exploiting the frustrations of the black community. This is John McKenzie for Nightline in Phoenix, Arizona.
Joining us from Hamburg, Germany, is the leader of the rap group Public Enemy, Chuck D. From our Washington bureau, Clarence Page, a syndicated columnist with the Chicago Tribune. And from Baltimore, J.D. Considine, pop music critic for the Baltimore Sun and a contributing editor of Musician Magazine. Chuck, I know that one of your fans said when he first saw the video, he was a little surprised by it, and then he thought about it, and he realized that you were just trying to get a rise out of people. Is that what you were trying to do?
Well, Forrest, there's a lot of reaction from a lot of people, and I think the purpose of rap music or any kind of music, I feel, is to raise dialogue. And the reason I raise dialogue on this particular issue because me as a black person has been tired of being disrespected, especially last year when the Bush administration kind of like went into the Persian Gulf on January 15th. That's what encouraged me to write the song.
You're getting awful far along for me here. Now, I thought you wrote the song because you were upset about Arizona not making the Martin Luther King birthday a holiday, and you thought you'd make a very strong point.
Well, it was a combination. I mean, not having the King holiday in Arizona and at the same time going into the Persian Gulf, going into war, a nonviolent person at the same time, Arizona not having this holiday, spurred me to write the song.
Well, it would seem in the minds of a lot of people a bit of a stretch to go from there to blowing away the governor of Arizona and some state officials.
Well, basically, I think this should be a fair place in America. But, you know, you have to realize in the video, we set a scenario, which can happen in the next 2 or 3 years, of a David Duke-type character going to win the governorship or all these are fictional characters in Arizona, corrupt officials, part of other organizations saying, no, we will not have a King holiday. Basically also pointing out that there has been so much hypocrisy and a big conspiracy against every single black leader that has come out, violent or nonviolent, or whatever they want to call them. Matter of fact, in the video, I'm making a statement against various things. The holiday that we celebrate in America, the 500 years of genocide on Columbus Day, and yet and still we're going to have a state that's not going to have a King holiday? That's ridiculous.
Mr. Page, what do you think about all that?
When I saw this video, I couldn't help but be reminded of what the Black Panthers used to say back in the 60s. You're either part of the solution or you're part of the problem. I think this video is part of the problem it's trying to address. Now, I don't expect journalistic integrity, so let's just talk about the message of the video. It juxtaposes legitimate historical scenes from the civil rights struggle with aggressive, violent revenge action, a revenge fantasy, if you will, as it has been described. That sends a clear message that the way to fight violence is with violence, the exact opposite of what Dr. Martin Luther King lived and, in the end, died for. That's what I, as an African-American, feel personally outraged about.
You see where the line is being drawn. There are those people who say, look, as Chuck does, this is the way that we make a strong artistic statement. We see a lot of violence out there, and this is the response that we have to it. On the other hand, people like Mr. Page say that's certainly the wrong way to go about this. Now,
what you've got to understand about the fight going on at this point isn't a matter of violence versus nonviolence. It's a matter of propaganda, of the message that says that, well, there are enough civil rights achievements at this point, we don't need a holiday, and people saying we're not anywhere close to an equal society, that we need to stress that there are still an awful lot of racist people in this country, an awful lot of racist behavior, and that this is not going to be tolerated. Now, if George Bush can get elected on the heels of a Willie Horton ad campaign, why can't Public Enemy make its point through a fantasy revenge video? And furthermore, why are people find it so upsetting to see a fantasy of non-existent Arizona politicians being shot or blown up or poisoned, and aren't quite as upset at seeing a reenactment of an actual person who was actually gunned down in an actual location?
That's not true. That's
Mr.
not
Page?
True. You're putting words into the mouths of the outraged. Why can we not be outraged at the entire cycle of violence, which is killing dozens of our young black males on the streets of Washington and every other major city in this country
this video,
every day?
Though?
Well, what
has
all your conspiracy theories got to do with this video either? I mean, the fact is, this video preaches a message that violence is the proper response to violence. That is not what
and
Dr.
So
King taught us.
Gentlemen, I want to stop it right there. Forgive me, we're out of time. A terrific discussion, and I thank you for joining us tonight.
Very interesting. There's no middle road. You have to... people vehemently defend or vehemently oppose it.
What occurred to me as I was watching it is, here we have this video that is going to be seen mostly by kids. We're concerned about how kids are going to react to it. And I would have liked to have heard some kids who have seen it and reacted to it. Somehow we sat and watched three adults talk about it, but I wanted to know what that black kid draws from that video.
Right. That is the way they saw it on last night's Nightline.
That's the way we saw it at World News Now. Another trading day has come and gone in Tokyo. For a look at how the Asian markets fared, here's NHK's Karuna Shinsho.
Hello from Tokyo, where the Speaker of Japan's Parliament says he didn't mean to insult American workers when he called them lazy. We'll have that story in a moment, but first, today's market news from Asia. Today, the Tokyo stock market hit a new 16-month low for the second day in a row as arbitrageurs continue to dominate bargain hunters. The Nikkei index fell nearly 56 points to close at a little over 20,858. The broader topics closed slightly over 1,569, down about 5 points. In currency markets, the dollar closed here at 123.34, up 0.09 from Toronto on Monday. New York markets were closed. It was lower against the mark, and the pound was higher against the greenback. In Hong Kong, the Hang Seng Index last hour was down to 4,502. In Singapore, the Straits Times Index stood at nearly 1,531. Turning to other news, the Speaker of Japan's Parliament, Yoshio Sakurauchi, softened his tone on the American workforce today. On Sunday, he said Japan's trade surplus with the United States was caused by lazy American workers. Today, he said he regretted that his remark were interpreted as insulting. He said he meant only to motivate the Americans to become more competitive. He denied that he ever said 30% of the American workforce could not read. Nevertheless, Japan's surplus with the United States in December was up 24%, or $870 million, from the month before to nearly $4.5 billion. For all of 1991, Japan's surplus with the United States was $38.4 billion, up only 1.3% from 1990. Worldwide, Japan's surplus showed its first year-on-year rise since 1986 to $78 billion. The biggest part of Japan's trade surplus is in cars and car parts, but automakers say exports will decline slightly this year. They say they'll sell nearly 6 million cars at home, up 4.5% from last year. But exports are projected to fall an average of 0.2% to nearly 4.8 million units. Mazda's target figure was the most optimistic at 11.5%. But today, Mazda lowered its 1991 profit forecast by a whopping 59%. Ford Motor Company owns 24% of Mazda. That's Asia Business Now from Tokyo. Now back to Aaron and Lisa in New York.
In the U.S., the Dow Jones Industrials lost more than 10 points yesterday, closing at 32.54. Trading was moderate. And that is the news for this half hour.
And this is World News Now. I'm Aaron Brown.
And I'm Lisa McCree. In the news at this hour, the White House gets ready to declare war on government red tape. A new study says getting a high school equivalency degree leaves you no better off than if you dropped out of school. For the fifth year in a row, the Chevy Camaro earns a highly dubious distinction. Coming up later in this half hour, weather and sports. Our affiliate showcase goes hunting for sharks and a profile of a painter on wheels. First, though, the news.
Well, there probably won't be any surprises left when the president delivers his State of the Union address a week from today. Just about all of it has leaked out in unconfirmed reports or another. Here is another, courtesy of some unnamed administration official. They say Mr. Bush is ready to impose a 90-day moratorium on most new federal regulations. They say the White House is looking in particular at regulations that impose what the White House believes are unfair burdens on business. The thinking is that those regulations stunt economic growth and contribute to unemployment.
The president's economic package is expected to include some tax breaks, and Congress has some ideas on that front, too. ABC's economics editor Stephen Ogg examines the possibilities.
Two of the tax proposals being considered by the administration and Congress center on housing. One would grant first-time homebuyers a tax credit ranging from $2,000 to $5,000 to be deducted from their federal income tax. So, for example, with a $2,000 credit, someone whose income tax is $10,000 would have to pay only $8,000 on April 15th. Someone getting a refund would get $2,000 more. Sandy and Alan Gardner are considering buying a new home, but their finances are tight.
Optimistically, we could put a bid on a house And then if it's a matter of $1,000 or $2, which it could very easily be, then this $2,000 tax credit can make the difference between buying and actually getting a house and not.
Another proposal would allow first-time home buyers to withdraw money without penalty from individual retirement accounts to help pay for a home. Both the IRA and particularly the tax credit plans, the reasoning goes, would help not only individuals, but would also help stimulate the housing industry and create jobs. Jay Buchert has a construction company in Cincinnati. He builds houses that cost $65,000. Recently, because he felt lower mortgage interest rates would bring out buyers, he poured foundations for 6 homes.
We would like to start about 10 more, but it will depend on whether or not the Congress goes ahead and enacts that tax credit legislation.
But both of these proposals would come at a cost. For example, if Congress allowed the $2,000 first-time home buyer credit, the government could lose at least $1 billion a year. Other proposals are equally expensive. For example, increasing the exemption for children could give families another $500 to $1,000 in disposable income, but it might cost another $5 billion a year. Congress and the president would either have to accept a bigger deficit or find places in the budget to make cuts. In an election year, not easy choices. Stephen Ogg, ABC News, Washington.
Some bad grades for the high school equivalency degree, commonly known as the GED. A study says those who get them are no better off than high school dropouts. Researchers from the University of Chicago found a 25-year-old with a GED earned about $3,800 a year. A 25-year-old dropout made just $500 less. The people who produced the high school equivalency exam call the study flawed and say the GED only measures academic ability, not earning power.
Tension between Ukraine and Russia still remains high. Ukrainian President Kravchuk dismissed new rumors that he plans to remove his country from the Commonwealth. One of the chief differences between the two republics surrounds the breakup of the old Soviet military. Ukraine has promised to return all nuclear weapons to Russian soil, a process that is already underway. And a French newspaper is reporting that Algeria could have the technology to build nuclear weapons within 3 to 5 years. Reports say nuclear reactor is now being constructed in Algeria. The Chinese are helping. Algeria is now being run by a military-backed regime, a regime that canceled elections earlier this month when Muslim fundamentalists nearly surged to power.
The UN Security Council is expected to pass a resolution later today that could bring two Libyans to justice for their role in the bombing of Pan Am Flight 103. The two Libyans were indicted by the U.S. and Britain for their part in the 1988 bombing that killed 270 people. Libya has denied any involvement in the Lockerbie crash. The families of the victims are far from pleased with the U.N. Dan Cohen is the father of one victim who thinks the resolution is not strong enough.
It has now been over 2 months, and the first action that has been taken is the resolution before the Security Council this afternoon. We have seen a draft of the resolution. It is pitiably weak. There is no demand for extradition. There are no deadlines. There is no call for sanctions.
Families are also upset that Syria and Iran have not been implicated along with Libya.
Aaron? Well, there is something about the 1986 Chevy Camaro that people love, isn't it? At least people who steal cars love it. In 1991, the 86 Camaro was, for the fifth year in a row, the most stolen car among those built by the big three automakers. Number two and number three were the 84 Olds Cutlass Supreme and the 87 Camaro. As for cars made by other people, like the Japanese, the 1988 Hyundai XL GL was number one on that list.
Well, the warm shall follow the cold. That is not biblical, that's just the weather. Record highs in the nation's midsection are pushing out the frigid air that's hung over for a week. Look for snow in New England, but in the south, warm and sunny. Rain in Texas and the lower Mississippi Valley. And along with today's forecast, how about some views from Bartlesville, Oklahoma, shot by cameraman Bob Abramson.
Thank you.
autopsy will be performed today on Oregon State sophomore Ernest Killam. He died yesterday, 3 days after his second stroke in 6 months. Killam was a star prospect for the Oregon State basketball team, but he played only a few games. His first stroke came last July, forcing him to sit out the season until he was activated December 27th. Officials at the hospital where he's being treated or was being treated said his death had nothing to do with basketball, but was caused by a blood clotting disorder. It took last-minute heroics by John Elway and the Denver Broncos to eliminate the Houston Oilers from this year's AFC playoffs. Warren Moon had as good a game as a quarterback could ask for that day, but it wasn't enough. In this half hour's ESPN interview, Roy Firestone talks to Warren Moon about disappointment and sitting out another Super Bowl. The latest scores accompany the discussion.
It must be frustrating because you obviously get so close year. 5 straight years is what it is of not getting beyond the second round. And this is one of the things I read. I remember after the game, you came the closest you could ever recall publicly to breaking down, but biting your lip. You didn't want to cry in front of the cameras.
I didn't, and that's the only reason why I didn't, because there was a million cameras in my face and all these Denver fans that were taunting me. But I didn't want to break down at that point, but I sure felt like it.
Mm. Well, let's talk about it, the misery part of it. This is painful to watch, but we're going to look at it one more time, the Denver loss, because it looked like you guys were in control, and that's probably why it hurts the most.
Yeah, we came out very aggressively, and we wanted to go right at them, for one, to try and get the crowd out of the game so we could do the things we wanted to do offensively, and two, to put some pressure on Elway to make him have to throw the ball a little bit more than he wanted to. And things worked well to the way we planned it, and we had control of the football game going into the third quarter.
Mm-hmm. And of course, this is the incredible comeback. I think watching on the sidelines was frustrating as hell, I'm sure, but you must have admired Elway a little bit.
Well, you know, you've seen him do this time and time again over his career, and you just never had it happen to you personally. And here I am watching on the sidelines, wishing I could be in there playing defensive back or linebacker or anything. And right here, when Vance Johnson ran by me, I thought seriously of sticking my foot out. I just wasn't sure what would have happened, what the repercussions would have been if I'd have done that.
You know, we had heard so many things. Sean Jones had said, and it sounds like sour grapes, and it's after the point, really, what point does it make? But it's still a point we can make, that there were holding calls all day long that weren't called, particularly Harvey Salem. Can you say for the record that yes, that was true, you saw holding, and that you should have had a better pass rush on that way, particularly in that final drive?
There was a lot of holding, and I think even some of Denver's players admitted that after the ball game. And at one point during the game, William Fuller was held on the play, and he said, "Referee, did you see that?" He said, "Yeah, and if he does that again, I'll call it." That type of thing.
Yeah, one of those kinds of things.
But when you're playing on the road and you're playing in that type of atmosphere, you can't expect any type of breaks or anything to go your way. You just have to beat all the odds, and we weren't able to do that day.
Was it the most devastating defeat you've ever had to endure?
I think it was, because there was so much expected of this team this year, and I really felt this team had a chance to go a lot further than we did. And having control of that game the way we did early in the ball game, and then letting it slip away like that was really tough to handle.
And that is sports for this half hour.
Coming up on the Affiliate Showcase, sharks, real ones, just the way you like them, up close and personal.
Some say the only way to experience life to the fullest is to take a risk. If that is true, then the payoff ought to be pretty good for anyone willing to dive into shark-infested waters. Fortunately, on our Affiliate Showcase today, we'll be able to check out that theory with no risk at all. Here's Steve Alvarez from ABC's Miami affiliate, WPLG.
We're feeding the sharks. Make sure that you keep your hands down, because these fellas come around and an arm or something could get in the way, and they're going to be snapping. We don't want to bring you out empty-handed.
It was meant to be funny, but my smile was a nervous one, because I was about to go looking for what most divers try to avoid: sharks, without a shark cage. My guide, Stuart Cove, a native of the Bahamas, who runs one of the few shark dive charters in the world. As we suited up, he talked about what we were about to see.
We're going to be diving today the bull shark wall. Doc's going to bring down some bait, and one of these we're going to prepare in some milk crates once we get you down and put it amongst us. And within a few minutes, we should have these big bull sharks swimming all around us. Now, the sharks are going to swim right up to you. If they come too close, you don't like them, just push them away with your hand. Okay, some of these sharks, we have one guy called Rambo. He's about 10 feet long, and he can be a bit of a worry. Just keep pushing him away, and
It's like a big puppy dog. Does anybody have any questions so far?
Just push him away, huh?
Just push him away.
Just push him away. I work in television. I'm used to being around sharks. Just seriously push them away?
Just push him away.
Just push him away. And with that, we took the plunge. As our group settled down along the reef, they were waiting for us, sharks, big and mean looking, and looking for food. It was lunchtime in the waters off the Bahamas. This is not the time most divers want to be in the water, but it was a perfect time to dispel old myths about sharks.
Up until recently, I think everybody's been frightened of sharks, think they are a real hazard to people and stuff. But I think due to work with a lot of different people, and including dive shops like ours, we're training people, or making them understand that sharks aren't a hazard. And they're really quite wonderful creatures and aren't going to bite people or eat people. They're not there to do that.
No, not at all. Sharks are lazy. They look for the easy feast. Dead fish on a spear are much easier than chasing live ones. And for the most part, they're not out to attack divers. The best way to learn this is up close. Very close, in their element. If they wanted to bite, they had plenty of opportunities. They swam freely among us, curious but not hostile. These fierce predators of the sea only wanted to look us over as we went eyeball to eyeball with them. Believe me, sitting still in the shark's feeding place took a while getting used to.
Most people, when they first go down with the sharks, are very frightened and apprehensive, but after they're in the water for a few minutes, they lose the fear and they start to appreciate them and to be awed by them.
After more than 200 shark dives, Stuart Cove remains in awe. He and his crew have worked shooting underwater scenes for movies like Splash, Cocoon, and James Bond films. But their work with sharks for National Geographic specials and the Discovery Channel have been the most rewarding.
I remember I was about 7 and a friend of mine and I were catching fish for our fish tank. And we had a little reef shark swim up on us, and that scared the pants off of us. We jumped right out of the water and into the boat, and I remember being very frightened of sharks. And especially after the Jaws movie came out, I believe it was in around 73, yeah, or whatever, and that terrified me.
You're gonna need a bigger boat.
But years later, after so many encounters on regular dive charters, Stuart and his crew decided it was time to take a closer look.
Well, we started diving with the silky sharks first, and that's a deep sea fishing area. And we always noticed an abundance of sharks there, and then we started snorkeling with them, and then started diving with them just for ourselves for fun. We started to take people on them, and so it was real popular, and then went from there. Yeah, it irritates some people.
Yeah,
we create shark dives around other diving locations, and there are other dive operations around this area who think we're crazy, and but as you can see, you've dived with some bull sharks and Caribbean reef sharks, and you can see they're not interested in biting you.
But they were interested and curious, as both man and shark got a peaceful, close-up look at one another. There were other things going on as well, groupers everywhere, and a pair of moray eels that wanted to share in the feast. But you never turned away from the sharks very long. In the afternoon, we moved to a second location, and guess what? One of the locals was waiting. I guess he spread the word, because as soon as we settled on the bottom, his friends showed up. Bull sharks, larger than the ones we saw on the first dive, and a bit more aggressive. Stuart and his crew had not spent as much time at this dive site, so the sharks weren't as comfortable with people, but they were just as hungry. Then it was my turn, holding bait on a spear just a few feet from my face. I couldn't help wonder what could go wrong, but again, Stuart was right. The sharks weren't out to get us. It was a remarkable experience. Diving with the ocean's most feared creatures changed our perceptions forever. You can't help but be changed by this.
And that is our affiliate showcase from Steve Alvarez, real smart guy from ABC's Miami station, WPLG. I can't believe he did that.
Well, just remember, whenever feeding a shark, keep your hands down. Ever wonder what the people watching this broadcast think? Just say yes. Don't be difficult. And since you asked, here are some letters to the editor phoned in to ABC News.
So I'm Dennis Rapon, and I'm from Fort Worth, Texas. I think that with looking back and seeing what all the forces have done over in Iraq and everything they've had to deal with, the pressures, both at far and at home, I think we should remember one thing. We could easily be fighting here on our home ground if our country didn't look at the future and what things are going on overseas and we didn't take the measures to stop them.
My name is Mary Hughes from McDermott, Ohio, and I'm calling to comment about health care. I'm currently unemployed, drawing unemployment. My husband's unemployed, but yet I make too much to qualify for a federal medical card, and I don't make enough to pay for health insurance. So far, I haven't seen any Democrat or Republican candidate that has come up with any kind of solution to the health care problem that we have. We have bills each month and no money to pay them, then there's something very wrong with this country.
Thank you for your calls. If you're inspired now to comment on the news or the way ABC covers the news, here's what you have to do. 1-900-787-7777. 95 cents a minute for the first minute, the last minute, and all minutes in between. And by the way, there's no point in waiting. This will never go on sale. If you are under 12 or act like it, please ask your parents. And as always in Louisiana, don't call at all, no matter your age. State law there protects you from these 900 calls, the good numbers, the bad numbers, and of course, the suggestive numbers. Also, in some remote parts of the country, the number doesn't work. The long-distance company we use promises swift action on this. I think this is now about the third week they promised that. Until they work it out, just feel like you're from Louisiana. Now, speaking of Louisiana, or sharks, or whatever it was we were speaking of, let's take a look at where the presidential candidates will be this day.
For most artists, success isn't measured by how much money they make or how the critics review their work. The art is the important thing. But even artists have to eat. One New York artist has taken his talents to the streets to make his living. Continuing now our series of reports by guys named Steve, here is Steve Hartman of ABC's New York television station WABC.
Don Shirky on Rembrandt.
I think I would add a little more color to it.
Don Shirky on Durr.
Somehow give it a little vitality.
Don Shirky could improve on most any portrait.
It's so complex that you start to miss the man.
Because Don Shirky does the world's greatest portraits. I know that because it says so on his cargo van. The one with Lee Iacocca and his wife. The one parked someplace different most every night. Don gives a whole new meaning to the words Van Gogh. Traversing the country painting oil portraits, this is his most recent commission. He says someday it'll be worth $100,000, and I have no reason to doubt him because, like he says, all the great masters started out like this.
Well, not in a truck.
No, not in a truck, yeah, but you know.
If you go back and chase most of the people, they painted portraits to try to make enough money until they got known well enough that people would then buy their other paintings.
That's why Don says it's best to get in on the ground floor.
Let's see a smile. No, we'd never do that.
While it's still relatively easy to book a sitting.
Just a soft smile, just a little bit of one. No, that's too much.
He does a quick sketch and then takes a Polaroid. Uses those to paint the portrait. Total cost about $200 or so.
I've done it for people that don't have any money, and I know don't have any money and really want one.
Besides, Don has to be flexible on price because not everyone out there appreciates the investment potential of a Don Shirky original. Which is fine. You don't need big bucks to be a success. Ultimately, self-confidence is all you need to prove yourself to yourself. And in art, yours is the only opinion that ever really matters anyway.
I hope that someday I leave something to this world that adds to the beauty of it.
Steve Hartman, Channel 7 Eyewitness News.
And finally, this half hour, a story from England about a man who has found a way to make money with his bananas. Nigel Hayward found he could get bank tellers, don't laugh yet, to give him cash if he pointed his bananas at them through his shirt. He doesn't get to do this often because British judges frown on this practice. But the last time the banana bandit was released from prison, he used his fruit to make $3,000. This time, he's been sentenced to 6 years in prison. No word about appeals.
Glad you had to read that, not me.
I was proud to read it. That's all.
This is World News Now.